Hi everybody, welcome to FoundFlix. On this Ending Explained, we'll be exploring the extreme head trip of Triangle, following a group of yacht passengers that encounter a storm that forces them to jump onto another mysterious ocean liner where they find themselves experiencing an increasingly convoluted, never-ending time-looping nightmare. Now before we get started, I'm bringing back the Viewer's Choice Ending Explained, so let's vote on which one you'd like to see. First up is 13 Ghosts, where a family inherits a spectacular old house which seems to have a dangerous agenda of its own, in addition to being haunted by several powerful and vengeful entities. Or Last Shift, where a rookie cop is ordered to take the last shift at a police station before being closed, and strange events lead her to believe it may be haunted. Let me know which one you want me to cover by commenting down below or voting in the poll over in the community tab. Triangle is definitely one of the greatest brain bogglers of all time, brimming with suspense and shocking twists as we slowly unfold the full story of what's going on, things becoming quickly quite difficult to follow, especially as more and more intricate pieces are introduced, and things become even more complicated with each new trip through the loop, and even more versions of our protagonist twist the plot into unexpected directions. Sorry to interrupt, but it's time for you to die. See, this is exactly what I'm talking about. Your future me, right? Yes, and I'm afraid you don't understand what's going on here. I'm doing this for my boy! Sorry about that, folks. Now, where was I? Or was he? Jeez, I'm already getting confused. There's a lot of ground to cover with this one. So let's take a mind-melting trip into the beyond with Triangle, breaking down the film's many plot points and how it all ties together, including the important character arc of our main character, Jess, and explaining the ending and what it means. Our out-of-context opening has young mother Jess holding her distressed child, telling him to close his eyes and think of something nice. She grabs her keys, drawn to a note on the fridge to meet Greg down at the harbor at 8:30. She tries to calm Tommy down to no avail, assuring him she's cleaned up his paint spill. She hears somebody ringing the doorbell, but by the time she goes out to check, there's no one around. Here, seeing her address is 237, our first reference to the evil room at the Overlook Hotel from The Shining. All of these pieces seen, not giving us the full picture of these moments on purpose. Jess makes it to the harbor looking quite distressed, but insists that she still wants to go sailing, joining Greg and some of his friends on the appropriately named Triangle. As they set sail, a seagull leaves the mast, the first of the omnipresent birds in our story. Later, passed out downstairs, Jess dreams of her on the beach, waves crashing at her legs, waking her up in confusion. Everyone besides Greg seems to kind of not like Jess, or maybe just because they don't know who she is. Victor informing Greg that she was acting weird on the dock, and when asking where her kid was, she stared into space a long while, answering that he was at school, despite it being Saturday. Greg explains that her son has special needs, and those schools are open every day, asking him to be nice to her, while his other friend Sally isn't a fan either. She brought along a friend of hers, Heather, to try and set up with Greg, and she's put off by this random woman that he's invited. Apparently, they've all known each other since school, and every year, Sally brings another girl to his annoyance. But he does seem to actually like Jess, having become friends by visiting the diner she works at, saying he typically only came in because he was hungry, but mentioning that yesterday was different. He expressly came to visit her and invite her to go sailing with them. Ah, well, isn't that adorable? Thanks for the invite, Greg. Their relaxing sailing trip soon takes a distressing turn when the wind suddenly drops. Not just drops, but is gone completely, leaving them idly floating in the water. They do have an engine, but everyone agrees that it's still unusual. Made even more so when Downey spots a massive electrical storm coming towards them. It descends right on top of them, turning everything dark. And it seems they've stumbled right into the fabled Bermuda Triangle. Greg tries for the Coast Guard on the radio, which gets interrupted, the frequency breaks, hearing a woman on the other end frantically calling for help, saying they're killing all of them. Well, that's distressing. He tries to get their coordinates, but there's no further response from the mysterious person. They're about to not be in a position to help anyone anyway, as the storm turns torrential, water furiously spilling onto the boat. And then an absolutely massive wave swells and crashes into the boat, flipping it over and sending everyone overboard, then clinging on to the overturned boat for refuge. Everyone makes it back to the boat, except for poor Heather, who was down below when the ship flipped, and unfortunately there is no sign of her after this, as something unbelievable crests through the storm's fog into view. A massive ocean liner, the Aeolus. Now certainly it couldn't be that a boat this size is completely empty, and the group shout out for help, seeing there is someone on board, looking down over towards them and then quickly backing away. Everyone hops onto the ship, trying to find anyone on board, yet it appears to be completely empty. They decide to find the deck and contact the Coast Guard, but wind up just kind of wandering aimlessly, getting lost in the massive ship. Though Jess is having a strange feeling of deja vu, as though she's been here before, even something about the specific hallway they're in sticking in her mind. Still on the search for anyone, a plaque details the history and meaning of the boat's name, which is from all the way back in 1932. When it comes to the name Aeolus, he was a Greek god of the winds, who cheated death and was punished by being forced to push a rock up a mountain all day, only for it to roll all the way back down to the bottom, starting the never-ending process all over again in an inescapable loop. Hearing a clank nearby, no one is there, but they do find a key ring, which oddly belongs to Jess. They at first don't believe her, but she recognizes every key and it even includes a photo of her son. So they have to believe her despite the strangeness. In the main ballroom, there is quite a huge looking spread of fresh food, as though people would have to be here, which does still seem to be the case, Jess seeing someone in a reflection that quickly darts away, sending Victor hustling after them. He's gone for a while, so Jess and Greg search for him, and again, Jess feels that she's been here before, hearing noises coming from a stateroom, room 237 in fact, another reference to the Overlook's infamous evil room. They find the sink on, and a message written in blood on the mirror telling them to go to the theater. Greg is undeterred, still wanting to go to the bridge, but she's worried about the blood and what that could mean. He tries to convince her it's just a sailor prank, and that all of her concerns are in her mind, and that ships don't appear out of nowhere, saying, well, maybe that happens in her world. She retorts that her world is her son, and vows to get off this boat no matter what, resulting in the two splitting up. Elsewhere, Sally and Downey come across what looks like blood trails on the ground, leading them to the theater, somehow already on their way there, despite not seeing Jess tell them, which he does go to do, expecting them to still be in the ballroom, but instead finding herself alone. She hones back in on the buffet spread, now looking all old and moldy. Its previous fresh appearance was only an illusion, and she's joined by another guest, an injured Victor stumbling in, immediately going for her throat, taking her to the ground, saying she's the one that injured him. She digs her finger into a hole in the back of his head, which kills him to her absolute shock. A shotgun blast rings out nearby, hearing Downey talking to Greg, pleading for him to stay with me, man. A bloody shotgun blast seen in his stomach. He too says that Jess is the one that shot him, but she's sure she couldn't have done it, and she wasn't even with him in the first place. What the heck is going on here? She informs them of Victor being attacked, and they say it was Jess that sent them to the theater in the first place, which she also denies. Calling her a psycho, more shots come down from the upper balcony. Someone in overalls and wearing a mask, who manages to get both Downey and Sally. Running outside, she unfortunately finds all the lifeboats are gone. Not gonna be that easy, Jess. Hearing footsteps above, the masked person gets her in the back, pointing the shotgun in her face. She begs for them to not shoot, the shooter straining to pull the trigger. When they decide to do so, Jess knocks the gun away, climbing over a railing. She finds an axe, and the killer brings their own new weapon. Jess disarms them, wanting to know who they are. After some incoherent babbling, hearing clearly the only way to go home is to kill them, and she swings the axe, sending the person overboard. She then hears some old-time big band music that kicks itself on a record player, and repeating the same loop over and over. She replaces the needle on the record, the song switching to a brassy take on Anchors Away. This version actually being by an artist whose plane mysteriously disappeared in the Bermuda Triangle. Seems appropriate. Suddenly hearing distressed voices outside screaming for help. Unbelievably, it's her and the rest of the gang huddled on the overturned boat, back at where this all began. As the record skip and other clues so far have shown us, there is a loop of time occurring, which begins with her and the others arriving, and a new loop has just started. So now we have a new Jess in the picture. For simplicity's sake, let's just go with Jess 2, and things start connecting together from the first loop. Like Jess 2 looking up suspiciously to that person on the boat looking down, which it turns out is our Jess that she's seeing. She doesn't have much time to take in what's happening, as the new group is already on board, trying to stay out of sight as she watches them relive what she just went through earlier. Ben becomes especially disturbed when seeing Jess 2 staring down that hallway and feeling deja vu, now understanding why. Dropping to the floor in distress, she drops her key ring as well, the sound drawing the others' attention, and Victor retrieving the keys, which, as we know, are actually Jess's. Also meaning that in the first loop we saw, there was already another previous loop's Jess in the mix as well. Jess Zero, if you will. And that's the one who dropped her keys during our Jess's time through the loop. And in the ballroom, it was that same previous Jess that R spotted in the reflection that Victor went after, which he does again, this time seeing seeing our Jess. She looks over the railing, seeing seagulls picking away on a body that looks like Downy as Victor comes outside. He's confused how she got here so fast, and she tries to explain that there's a copy of her downstairs, but he only becomes even more confused. She tries to show him the body in the water, but it's somehow no longer there. Starting to get frantic, she realizes they should have never boarded the ship. If they had stayed on the sailboat, everyone would still be alive. She grabs his head, trying to get through to him, inadvertently stabbing him into a random pokey thing in the wall through the back of his head. What the heck is that thing doing here anyway? What is that for? I have no idea, just a bunch of pokey shit sticking out. And now we understand that Victor wasn't lying about Jess attacking him, it was just another earlier copy that did so and not ours. Overhearing her and Greg, accusing everything of being in her mind, she stumbles across a pile of notes on the ground in her room, all of them reading the same thing. If they board, kill them. She decides to write the note herself, throwing it into the pile, and when picking it out, she can't tell the difference, meaning that she actually wrote all these notes in previous loops, beginning to illustrate just how many times this has already occurred. She remembers back to the masked person saying the same thing about killing them all, and is now convinced she has no other choice, loading up a shotgun, as the voices in her head become more intense. She gets even more evidence of the sheer number of loops when finding her locket dangling in a grate. She retrieves it, but is horrified to see a large pile of the exact same locket down below, causing her to drop hers, falling down and joining the others. Yikes! It is looking like all this has happened beat for beat untold number of times already. Hopefully she can find out a way to break this loop, which she immediately attempts to do by changing what happened before, trying to talk to the wounded Victor, saying that she didn't mean to hurt him, which is tough to believe with a shotgun in the face. And after Jess too enters the ballroom, leading to their previous scuffle, our Jess steps in, coming face to face with her double. She considers killing Jess too, saying it's not really her, but she can't get herself to do it, and Jess too runs off. She's still excited though, as she does appear to have done something different this time, as what we saw didn't happen before. But Victor can't really express much enthusiasm, as he soon dies from his injury, though other things happen just the same. Hearing the shotgun, and Greg is still shot, yet this time she is able to whisk the couple at least to safety, and explains that if they can change the pattern, they can escape, warning them to not trust anyone. Going back for Victor, she assumes he fell over the side. And here's a shot from Downy, shouting out, "Who is it?" It's the mask-wearing killer, who removes their mask, and we see it's another Jess underneath, our so-called bad Jess. The couple doesn't know any better, and blindly trust her when she says to follow her if they want to live, where she leads them to room 237, and quickly lives up to her bad Jess moniker, first apologizing, saying she's only doing this for her son, then brutally attacking them both with a knife, slaying Downy, but Sally does get away. Our main Jess encounters Sally and tries to explain that it wasn't her, but she doesn't believe her and loses her in the bowels of the ship. Jess finds herself at a radio and makes a desperate plea for help, and it's Greg heard on the other end, making it clear the transmission they heard before the crash was actually Jess from this moment now. Approaching the top deck, seagulls all over the place, she finds Sally writhing away amongst a massive pile of dead Sallys from previous loops, showing us again that even though she thought she changed things, everything was still part of a bigger, inescapable loop. Even Jess giving up her sweater to comfort Sally. Several are seen also with the same sweater on their bodies. Peering over the side, we see Jess too fighting what we now know is bad Jess. Interestingly, this time, this Jess beats the hell out of the other her and tosses her overboard, rather than the big whiff of a swing ours did in her encounter with the masked killer, who here also, quite oddly, is unmasked, meaning this Jess knew the killer was her and still elected to dispatch them. Pretty cold-blooded, Jess. And she now understands the loop resets when everyone dies, and knowing it's about to reset, is hopeful that she can get everyone back on board the Triangle and thusly all escape this nightmare. But by the time the next group shows up and she gets to the side of the boat, the yacht has already drifted away. Well, so much for that plan. And now she has become convinced of the necessity to kill everyone to reset the loop and try again. Returning to room 237, finding Downey's body, before dying, he wrote her name in blood, which she changes to the meet at the theater note that she and Greg saw earlier, and dumps Downey's body overboard, that being whose body she saw earlier in the water getting eaten. And if she had left the body, that would kind of mess things up, as we know the bodies don't don't seem to reset with the loops. She then goes to Sally and the new Downey in the ballroom, telling them to go to the theater. So it was actually her that did lead them to their dooms. And then she suits up and becomes the killer, or Bad Jess herself. She feels like she has no other option than kill everyone herself to reset the loop and hopefully fix things the next go around. Hearing the same conversation between now Jess 3 and Greg when they split up, she corners him. But her identity is quickly found out by her sandals. Greg confused by what she's doing. She tries to explain that this isn't really her. She's still somehow out there on the yacht, and he's there with her. So long as she kills them, they'll return. So she blows him away, knocking him over the balcony. Reloading, she opens fire on everyone below, now in the reverse position of herself earlier. Except now our Jess is the mass killer, turning the gun on herself, and decides to fire, getting outmaneuvered just as she did before, and tells this Jess the same thing the other told her. They'll return if you kill them before plummeting into the water. Rather than dying, she later regains consciousness on the beach, now living the dream that she saw when sleeping way back on the boat before. She manages to get back to her house, and what we soon come to realize is that we're actually back at the beginning of events chronologically, a bit before the 8:30 meeting at the harbor. She goes to the window of her house, seeing little Tommy inside painting, hearing herself saying they're going to be late and getting laundry off the line. While before we only saw her retrieve a boat from the kiddie pool, now we see the aftermath. Jess actually getting furious at her son and really tearing into him for leaving his toys out. Looking out the window, he's shocked, seeing our Jess, causing him to spill the paint, infuriating her again, and slapping Tommy in anger for the simple accident. And wow, turns out Jess is a stone cold bitch and pretty terrible mother to her special needs son. Seems that she has only now come to realize just how bad she was, and now deeply regrets her behavior after her trippy voyage. She rings the doorbell and stomps off, connecting to the same moment from the opening. Now seeing our Jess retrieving a hammer from a shed, surprising her other self as she's putting on makeup and killing herself, her other self, little Tommy witnesses the whole thing, which must be equally confusing and distressing. Our Jess tries to comfort him, saying it's just a bad dream. Another brief segment we saw back at the beginning, but without all the context from before, this changes everything we saw. This also informs us that the Jess we followed at the very beginning of the movie was also killed by another Jess at this stage of her very long loop. Putting her doppelganger self in a clothes bag in the trunk, she promises a still freaking out Tommy things will be different now, assuring him she won't ever lose her temper at him again, and that the woman who did those things isn't really his mom, something she's used consistently to defend her behavior throughout. She hits a bird, which turns out to be a seagull, and tells Tommy that they'll bury it, taking it from the road and tossing it on the beach. And just as with her locket and the mini Sally's, there's a pile of dead seagulls right where she tosses it, indicating once again that despite her thinking she's changed things, this is all still part of her loop. She runs back to her car in a hurry, to Tommy screaming insanely. She yells for him to stop, getting distracted by his tantrum and crashing right into a semi, flipping the car a whole bunch of times. In the aftermath, we find our Jess standing blankly near the wreck, which not only exposed the Jess she killed, but resulted in the death of her son. The same bloody pattern on her face seen as with Bad Jess prior when she was unmasked. Also interestingly, one of the Drumline Kids logos we see on his drum is the same from the ship's band setup on the Aeolus. And the random guy approaches her asking if she's alright. When asking who he is, he only replies a driver, telling her there's no point in trying to save the boy, and that there's nothing she can do to bring him back. He offers to give her a ride, and she, still unwilling to give up despite the total inescapable futility of her situation, asks to be taken to the harbor, connecting the events from her house to when she showed up in a daze there at the beginning. And now I understand why, since she did sort of kill her son, but still refuses to accept this reality. As we know with the doomed Aeolus, she is stuck in her situation, and will be reliving the same pointless fight for eternity, rolling up the rock, only for it to fall back down and start all over again. And the driver here is actually a stand-in for the mythical ferryman who ushers souls to the afterlife. And when he takes her to the harbor, he says he's leaving the meter running and she promises to be right back, which we know is never going to happen. And in this sense, she is effectively cheating death, just as her ancient counterpart did, her punishment being living this time loop infinitely, as she joins the triangle and the whole twisted thing starts from scratch all over again. It's by refusing to accept the fact that her son is dead and that she can't do anything about it that she's doomed to be punished forever. Oh well, that's kind of a bummer. Okay, now that we've decoded Jess's extremely convoluted journey, let's look at some other major questions that I still had. One that actually still confused me after watching the movie again is when does Jess reset in the loop? Because technically the Jess at the beginning has already lived through the whole movie already, yet only appears to have flutters of deja vu and familiarity. Something must cause her to more or less lose her memories, and the moment that I've pegged is when, first boarding the Triangle, she takes a long nap, and here has the dream of being on the beach. Again, technically this has already happened, yet Jess suddenly only remembers it as a dream, as it's from this point that she seems unaware of what is going on with the doubles and the loops and everything, and since she doesn't remember everything, she's forced to learn the hard way, step by step, all over again to uncover what's going on. Which brings us to what the deal is with the Aeolus and the whole Bermuda Triangle aspect of the story. If you don't know, the Bermuda Triangle is an area where over the years many aircrafts and ships have gone mysteriously missing, and now has become regarded as a kind of cursed area. Part of the Triangle area does include Florida, where our group set sail from, so they definitely could have traveled into this paranormal zone, and it is considered to have claimed the many vessels that were lost. So it's like the Aeolus was from the 1930s when it originally set sail, and it too ventured into the Triangle and became lost in time. And due to being lost in time, time itself has been warped on board, which explains all the time loop insanity. However, I honestly also feel like it has a more personal meaning to Jess, almost as though the Aeolus is purgatory, where she is forced to face what is important and learn how much she cares for her kid and wanting to change, only to learn the even more painful lesson in the end that it's too late and there's nothing that she can do to rectify it, having to accept that she was a shithead. Now, we don't really see the aftermath of the car crash, and the filmmakers did use skipping over things to confuse us before, so I wonder if she actually did perish in the crash, and the driver was actually there to take her to the afterlife. But since she cheated death and wanted to do what she could to save her son, she went that route instead, and the result being that never-ending rock punishment. This just kind of makes a little bit more sense to me, because in the end, the loop does extend outside of the ocean liner and all the way back onto land, as though the entire reality we were presented with the whole time has been affected by the time loop. And this all fits in with Jess's brutal facing of her own past behavior and being a total a-hole to her kid. That was who she really was, not the caring mother that she became or convinced herself that she was. But by then, it was too late to change. And anyway, who in the world would name a boat the Aeolus? Doesn't exactly roll off the tongue, you know. Should be like the Destiny or a Serenity or something. It's like the boat itself is informing us of Jess's situation from the very beginning, encountering a part of the afterlife where she has to face her biggest mistakes and what she's willing to do to fix them, including killing innocent people and ultimately herself over and over again. Well, that about wraps it up for this in-depth look at Triangle. As we learned, there's no hope in trying to fight against fate, no matter how much you try. And that's... can't let you do that, friend. Oh great, not again. You know what must be done. Wait, so you're FoundFlix, the one that died in the wreck with the face and everything, or? Yeah, totally. I think so.
You think so?
Yeah, I don't know, okay? All this shit is like really confusing. The only thing that I do know is that you are supposed to die. But that was the whole point, is that you can't fix it, you fool.
Ow. Jeez, getting crowded over here with all the bodies.
Yeah, and don't forget, you can send me requests for any movies or TV shows you'd like to see me explain by sending them my way on any of my social media accounts at FoundFlix. And make sure to vote in our viewer's choice poll, 13 Ghosts or Last Shift. Thanks, guys. What did you guys think of Triangle and its ending? Do you have any other theories about what's going on in the movie? Leave your thoughts in the comments below. Make sure to like, subscribe, and follow. Thanks for watching FoundFlix. See you next time.